Good evening, everybody. Welcome to this interventional rounds conducted by Vinkar. And today our topic is angioplasty of anomalous coronary artery. To join me in this discussion is Dr. Rupa Salwan, a senior interventional cardiologist from Delhi. Along with her, we have Dr. Rupali Khanna, me, myself, Dr. Lalita from NIMS, and possibly we'll be having Dr. Josna, who will be joining us also as an expert panelist. So before we go on with this angioplasty in the anomalous coronary arteries, the basic thing we are going to do today is we are dealing with anomalous origin of anomalous coronary arteries. And because this is a class for the students, we will start with a basic discussion as what exactly is an anomalous coronary artery. We all know it is a congenital abnormality, a very rare abnormality. And basically, as the name indicates, it is a deviation from the normal coronary pattern. So I'll hand it over to Dr. Rupa Salwan, madam, to start with the initial discussion of anomalous coronary artery.
Thank you very much, Lalita. And indeed, it's a great pleasure to be a part of this discussion. And I must, I'm sure all of you know about Vinkar, but I think it's a fabulous platform that gets a lot of us women who are practicing cardiology, intervention cardiology, EP together. And it's a fabulous group and I'm very proud to be a part of it. So here we go. So the coronary arteries development in our future. So basically vascular... There's too much interruption. Dignesh, please mute other people. Admin, please mute others.
Dignesh, can you mute vascular others, please, once again?
Basically, the subcardial... Shivani, please. They form primitive vessels that invade the myocardium and sprouts, and these grow towards buds, where the bulbous cordis is dividing into the aorta and the pulmonary artery and fuse to form the coronary arteries. So in normal, we know that there's a left coronary artery that divides into the LAD and the circumflex and a right coronary artery. And anomaly is something that is seen in less than 1% of the population. So it could include an anomaly of its origin of the course of the vessel and the termination of the vessel. So this is how a regular, you know, artery looks like, the right, the left main dividing into its branches, which all of us are familiar with. Now, what is important is that the name and the nature of the artery refers to the dependent territory that they feed, not their territory. So when we talk of a right coronary artery, it supplies the right free wall and it is seen in the right AV sulcus and it gives an acute marginal branch. The vessel that we call the LAD is supplying the intraventricular septum. It is seen in the anterior intraventricular sulcus and it has septal perforators. And the vessel that we call circumflex supplies the free wall of the left ventricle. It is seen in the left AV sulcus and it gives obtuse marginal branches. So now, in a very classical paper published by Angelini in 2007, the coronary anomalies that were described, the ectopic origin of the right coronary artery from the left sinus was seen in 0.92% of cases. A circumflex arising from the right sinus in 0.67% of the cases and a left coronary artery arising from the right sinus in 0.15% of cases. So basically, anomalous origin of the right coronary artery is almost 6 times more common than anomalous origin of the left coronary artery. So if, again, this is a classical description given by the same author, where if you were to see the pulmonary artery aorta and the branches, this is how a normal vessel looks, the right and the left dividing into the two. And other course could be a retrocardiac where the right is very big and is just continuing as the circ all the way up. Or it could have a retroaortic course where the circumflex may arise near the right sinus, pass behind the aorta and distribute in the territory of the circumflex. Or it could be an interarterial course between the two vessels. It could be a prepulmonary across the RV outflow tract to supply the LAD territory. Or it could be a little below through the septum to supply again the LAD territory. Now, in a classic paper by Sirota, given in 1990 in the American Journal of Cardiology, The distribution, this eye and dot pattern, particularly for all PGs, I think it becomes a very important paper and an understanding. And I will go a little slow on this with requesting Rupali and Lalita to give their inputs when I describe it. So what they did was they actually studied the angiograms and they created models and they took CINAHE to understand how it looks like. And this first description is for a left main that is coming from the right sinus of Valsalva. So in, way back in 1990, what they would do is a LV angiogram or an iotogram in an RAO 30 degrees. And in that, you could see either an eye pattern like this or a dot. Okay, so an eye pattern was seen if the left main either went through the septum to form the LAD or it went across the RV outflow tract to again give rise to the LAD and the circumflex. Now, if the left main went behind the aorta, you saw a dot behind the aorta. And if it was an interarterial course, you saw a dot in front of the aorta. Now, interestingly, the same pattern, if the circumflex is coming from the right sinus and is wrapping around the aorta, also you see a posterior dot. And if the right artery is arising from the left sinus going between the arteries, you tend to see an anterior dot. So in a LV angiogram, the dot would appear like this and the eye would appear like, like this. So in the septal form, you would find the left main below and the circumflex above. And in the anterior, in the septal form, the left main would be above and the circumflex below. And when it goes across the RV outflow, the left main is here and you find the septal forming the upper part of the eye. So anything you'd want to add, girls, Rupali or Lalita, on this? Or the question that PGs are asked in the exam and stuff like that?
Yeah, actually, this is a usual question which is given to our PGs. Like, I always ask our residents to at least see the course of the artery. It is important because we always say interarterial course will definitely have a poor prognosis, whatever the other different courses are there. So very rightly mentioned by ma'am in this diagram. So what we usually say, always we go for a RAO view. So when you are going for this injection or with this, you always take a RAO view, which is important, which will tell us about the course of the artery. In RAO view, always try to divide the artery into four quadrants. So suppose if you're putting a catheter and divide into four quadrants, anterior, posterior, cranial and caudal. So this will help us in dividing, analyzing the course. So if you see that if there is a catheter, if the artery is going anteriorly to it and it is going the posterior to it. If anteriorly, we have to see whether the artery is having a cranial course or the artery is having a caudal course. Same way, posteriorly, we have to see whether it's a cranial and the caudal. So it becomes easy, rather I and dot is okay, but clinically, when we see, suppose the artery is going anteriorly and cranially, it is usually a course which is anterior to RVOT. That is your anterior free wall, because if we imagine the pulmonary artery is always on the anterior side. If it goes anteriorly and caudally, it is a septal course. If same way posteriorly, if it is going up posteriorly and cranially, that means it is more like a retroaortic course. And posteriorly and caudally, it is more like a interarterial or an end-on course in these cases. So in that way, it is important to analyze the course. In septal, in this, as ma'am showed, the left main, which is arising having a septal course, this identification of the septal artery becomes very important, because sometimes it becomes very difficult to say whether it's an LAD or an LCX, because they will both make an I sign. So how to identify that this is I sign, the lower part is LAD or LCX? Always look for the septal arteries. If the septal artery is coming from the lower part, that means from a septal course. And if you're not getting seen septal artery, a plain artery going in the lower part, that means it's your LCX is forming the lower border, and that means it's an anterior free wall course. So this is the common, I would say, the VIVA questions and the VIVA spotters which we give to PG students to find the course of the artery.
One more thing I want to add is about the retro in between the pulmonary artery and the aorta. In the cath, we used to say that they put a catheter into the pulmonary artery and they take their injections. But nowadays, with the CT in availability, it becomes so easy that we can make it out this course of the vessels very easily.
Yeah, agreed, Bhat, because now CT has become the gold standard modality to identify the course, because you always never give 100% information in these cases.
And what is even more interesting is CT scan has shown that always it's the vessel is not between the two aorta and the pulmonary artery. It is sometimes an intussusception in the wall of the aorta. And that's what gives that oval or an oblong or a very patulous look to the proximal part of the vessels. So it has really improved our understanding. And also that tells us why it's not necessary that there will be kind of a scissor effect where this will get compressed between the two arteries. So our whole understanding of this whole interarterial course, its risks, is changing as we getting better methods to image these vessels.
Actually, now they are saying the interarterial course. It's not always. It's always better to document that part is causing ischemia, because earlier the concept was interarterial course going for a surgery. Surgeon always want, okay, just show that whether this artery is because of interarterial course causing ischemia or not. So you have to document inducible ischemia in these cases. Then only we have to hold up for the surgery in these cases nowadays.
Yeah, correct. And then again, even there are studies of IVOS where they show it's oval. So, you know, they are not symmetrical in two planes. But that doesn't mean you have to go and treat them. It doesn't mean you have to scan them. Still, there will be not necessarily there will be ischemia down that vessel. So our whole understanding, you know, I know in my experience, I've never had to send a patient to surgery for this. And most of them are negative on nuclear scans or evaluation. I have not done IVOS, but I've seen those studies and I would be very reluctant to intervene in these arteries, which are normal for that patient. Unless there's atherosclerosis, you don't need to intervene in these vessels. And of course, as a precaution, we don't ask them to do competitive sports. Having said that, we don't have so many competitive sports in our country. And going ahead, when they happen, CT, documenting, ischemia, all this will be important to protect them from sudden cardiac death.
Yeah, rightly pointed out, because I think the anomalous coronary artery is the second most important cause for sudden cardiac death in young people after hypertrophic cardiomyopathy. Yeah. And the point to add, ma'am, in anomalous, like we say that they are more prone for giving atherosclerosis or more prone for giving your causing ischemia. There are two, three thoughts that what you say. One is that the opening. The opening is around in these cases, a normal coronary artery. But here the opening is either an oval or a slit opening.
Yeah.
And because of angulation and the flow pattern which happens, there may be chances that there will be increased atherosclerosis because of turbulence or whatever. They have more chances of developing stenosis in these cases.
These arteries are more prone for the atherosclerosis than the normal taking in origin. Not just because of the ostium, it is an angulated tooth, is an aorta. As you already mentioned, the flow becomes more turbulent because of the origin. And they divided into the different segments into the artery. And they did the intra-Doppler demonstration of the vessel flows, which are going to be the abnormal beyond the ostial level. So they said that these anomalous arteries are the much more prone to the atherosclerosis than the normal coronaries, normal origin of the coronaries.
Yeah, ma'am, correct.
Okay, so I go ahead now. So this is real life. Okay, and I must, before I start this, thank all my colleagues because, you know, a lot of, I've just been collecting these cases over the years, more than 10, 15 years. So, and they are from my department and my colleagues and half of them are mine, some are from the others. So this is real life. It's a regular angiogram in a 56-year-old lady. And you do put a left catheter and you get nothing. And it can be very, you know, intimidating when you start your careers because, you know ki left catheter is meant to hook the artery and it's horrible to, you know, find ki are left bhi nahi hook hoga, right to dur ki baat hai. So, but it's all right. It happens. And if you don't see the vessels on this kind of a sinogram, next step is you put in a pigtail and you do an angiogram in the RAO 30 degrees. And if you see in this angiogram, what you make out, just see carefully in this, you will see a loop anteriorly. Okay, you see some loop out there. And you're seeing a dot out here. Now, all that dot and eye pattern and everything just goes for a 6 in this. You know, there's a vessel that's passing retro aortic and it is forming a loop out here, but you don't know anything more on an angiogram like this. So, again, more for documenting. And again, it's early in your exposure when you then shift from RAO to LAO to get a better idea where to probe. And you see that there's an RCA coming out, there's a circumflex or some vessel going around and winding up. So when you see this area, the commonest catheter that you use is an amplatz. And with an amplatz, an AL1, so the first vessel that gets hooked is a left main, or that is winding retro aortic. And it is giving rise to a big branch here and a circumflex. And the next image that is taken, then you see the same vessel, that retroaortic, that posterior dot that we were talking of. Okay, so that posterior dot winding around, giving us circumflex, OM branches, and an anterior branch, which is going all the way around and giving a big PD. So it looks like almost everything is coming out from here. But when we did the non-selective, we did see more vessels, and just leaving it at this may not be right. So you move the catheter a bit and you change for a Judkins, and here you hook another vessel. Now, when you hook this vessel, it's definitely not the right. And you've seen such a huge LAD, then what is this vessel out here? So you go ahead, take a cranial view, and you realize that the lower part of the LAD is what is being filled by this vessel. And this is what happens sometimes. The upper part is coming through that, but this is almost like a dual LAD. Now, this, I must point out, I have read case reports where a patient has come with an anterior STEMI and they found the natural, the LAD looking fine, and ectopic LAD from the RC, which was responsible for the anterior MI. So don't be, you know, so this is a very good demonstration of, despite seeing a good LAD wrap around in the last view, you see another vessel coming and supplying the apical part of the interventional LV. And a non-dominant.
Can you go back to the forum?
Vessel that looks so huge, you just have, and when you see, if I go back, I'll just show it to you. For a vessel as big as this, which is supplying practically everything, it was not enough. And the patient also has two more arteries, one an LAD, a dual LAD, and second is a RCA. So any comments any of you would like to give on this? So this is real life. You know, you get lost and all the theory gets left behind. You have to take your catheters and find it out. And probing the aortic root in these positions tells you really where the vessels are and what they are like. And doing a complete angiogram is extremely important. Jyotsna ma'am, anything you'd say?
Yeah, that's what I was about to say, madam. The thing is, we have to see that each every component of the myocardium is getting the blood supply or not. Because just because we are able to see the some branches, we can't be certain that we could get the information of all the three blood vessels. So every component of the artery of the myocardium is getting the blood supply or not. Your point is well taken. In the previous view, LAD is going up to the apex. So the so we don't expect that the anomalous LAD, another LAD is likely to be the present. So in this type of the cases, it is difficult to guess it. Can you give any clues why you are thought that there is another vessel? Because if it is, it's already supplied by the perfectly by the previous LAD. So why you suspected there is another vessel? What made you to think about it?
So in this LAO angiogram, you see a vessel coming clearly out here. And the other one is going out here. So you're doing, now we are doing a right coronary Judkins right catheter, and we are trying to get that RCA, and we get into this vessel. That's what it is. We are actually trying to get that. So it's not that we saw this, we didn't expect it. But you know, the catheter tends to hook, it tends to find the mouth of the ostia, and wherever you find it hooking, you must you know, just take a chair, puff and see it. And all these ostia so close to each other. So when you rotate out clockwise from, you know, the circumflex to this LAD, and then you get the RC, that's the way in which you'll get them. So, and this, you have to know, this I think is extremely important, because that case report I read where a patient had STEMI and they could not find the vessel and they found an anomalous. See, the eyes don't see what the mind doesn't know. So if you're in a situation like that, you will take a catheter and you will look for it, and sure enough, you'll find it. Usually the dual LADs come from the right sinus. And in this, so while the circumflex comes, you know, before, you have to go anti-clockwise to get the circumflex. To get the LAD, you have to go a little more clockwise, and then you will hit the LAD.
But only problem to say the dual LAD is, LAD, if supplying, one of the LAD supplying to the septals, giving the septals, other LADs give the diagonals, then we can be certain that it is a dual LAD. Otherwise, it is a simple branch, or should we call as a dual LADs also is a pickup is other problem. Like in this, what is another vessel is shown is only the one so-called the diagonal is seen. But there we are able to see the both the septals and diagonals. So this controversy becomes about the nomenclature of this.
It's a nomenclature. As long as you know something like this is, whatever people call it, this is, I mean, in the cath lab, you find it and you know if you have to deal with it, you deal with it. You know, don't be surprised if you see an LAD and you still have a STEMI and you have to look for another LAD, go into the right sinus and find it. And it's not so hard, you'll find it. And it's the normal catheter, the Judkins right, that you can get to it. So now I will show you, so from all the vessels coming from the right sinus, now I'm going to show you a patient. Again, he came, so most of my work is STEMI and acute interventions, and that's really what my core strength is. So this is a patient who comes with an inferior wall MI, and you do a left coronary diagnostic, and there you see the right coronary arteries coming from the left main. Now, all the development and the absorption and everything, this is the course which an anamylous artery takes. So in an LAO, this is from where it's... So, you know, if an artery has a separate origin from the left sinus, just visualize, this is the path it really takes. And here it's coming all the way from the left main. Now, for something like this, I would take a regular, you know, EBU guide, and via the vessel, it gives you the support and you will be able to do an angioplasty, and that's what I did. So I have an EBU guide, and you via this vessel, there's not much of an issue. The left main gives you the support, predilate and stent, and you get a good result on this. So this is a single coronary artery from the left sinus. The RCA is coming from the left main. Very unusual, but very easy to cannulate. It doesn't trouble you. Again, you see it, you know it, and you just go the normal way you do a LAD angioplasty, you will not have a problem.
But only one precaution we have to take it is directly wiring the only to the anomalous vessel is not sufficient in this, because it is likely to the prolapse very easily. So better to have the wiring of the at least of the LAD, and when you are doing an angioplasty to the RCA in this anomalous vessel.
At least I didn't. So this is a 7 French guiding, and usually for support, as you see, I've gone through the groin. I haven't done it radial. And did STEMIs through the groin. This is way back, you know, I think in 2010. So it is 10 years ago. So it is, support is good. EBU is good because it supports you from the opposite wall. Yes, if you find a prolapse of your catheter, then you take an anchoring wire. That's not a big thing. But usually with this left main and an EBU, you don't have so much of an issue. Unlike all the anamylous rights, I'll show you where, yes, there would be issues.
So ideally, this being a single coronary artery, it's better that you protect the other vessel also. So ideally, you put a wire in the other vessel, that is a two-wire technique, and then go, because that is a single coronary artery, which is a geopardy. So even if you're doing for the culprit vessel, the second vessel should also be protected.
I can't hear.
Ma'am, you are heard. I think you, you are not able to hear us.
Lalita's concern is about, because it's a single coronary artery, all the branches are coming, that even though it is not prolapsing or giving a good support, because it is a deep penetration of the EBU into the left main is required, better to have the wiring of the other vessels and have a protection to the other vessels. That's what she's saying, the concern about wiring of the other vessels.
So they are in different directions, you know, they are totally in different directions, but having said that, no harm. Put another wire, no harm.
And second thing is having a wire in the second vessel.
It is, you know your circumstances, your backup the best. Please, there's absolutely no harm in having a wire into the other vessels. I won't even argue on that. If you think it's right while doing it, first operator knows best what is safe for a patient. Please go ahead. You will not harm the patient by doing that. Okay, so go ahead.
Yeah, please go ahead.
So this is something that we see more commonly. Okay, so it's a circumflex arising from the right. So when you take a regular Judkins guiding catheter, you'd see it, and you have to rotate it a little anti-clockwise to align the ostium of your guide with the circumflex. Wiring it is not so much of an issue, and stenting it. As you see, this is again in 2009. This patient still comes. The stents are looking as good. You know, and you'd be surprised, this was actually a Yukon for cost saving, and this was an endeavor at that time for the curve. So, you know, how you balance out on cost and things. And this patient's vessels are actually looking better. The whole distal RCA has grown 10 years later. All that has grown without any stents distally. So this is a regular Judkins right guiding, and rotate it a little anti-clockwise. So rotation is always from your left hand, not from the right hand, okay? Not at the hub of the catheter. At the tip of the catheter, rotate it. When you get it a little pointing towards the circumflex, slip your wire by. Use your regular wire, whatever is your workhorse wire. BMW is the wire which I use regularly. But whether it's a Scion Blue or any other wire that you're regularly using in your ward, slip it by. There won't be any issue at all. And stents, passage, nothing. You don't really worry about it. If it's bobbing in and out, yes, you can have a second wire down the RCA to support it. But usually that rotates the guide in the opposite direction. You don't want it. So in this one, the moment you have a balloon here, the guide will just rotate anti-clockwise towards the circumflex, and delivering any stent down this vessel is usually not a problem. So I will show you another patient who comes with an inferior wall MI. Again, on the left injection, you don't see anything. And when you take a right Judkin's right catheter and you hook whatever vessel you feel at the ostium, you see a huge left coming out, you see a right. And if you're not careful, you'll miss it. This little stain of dye out here, that is a circumflex. So then we go in with a guiding catheter and we're not touching the right and the LAD. And this is the circumflex that is occluded. And again, in this, it's not so much of an issue. You can cross it with a wire and then directly stent this vessel. Again, you see it's a huge vessel which gives out, you know, so many branches, OMs, and also, so these are all OMs. There's nothing really in the LAD territory or giving septals. And we could argue again for nomenclature whether this is a finer branch, which, but we saw a huge LAD in the other vessel. So the whole lateral wall is supplied by this, and this point was stented. So this you see is the maximum amount, the lack of alignment of the RCA. And, but today technology, the stents are so low profile, you will never encounter a problem in passing a stent down this vessel. If you do, you can pass a second wire, but I don't think I've seen anybody really get into trouble on this. And with the balloon inflated, you're able to give a little more rotation anti-clockwise and you can align it. I'll show you another case where a circumflex is coming down. And here, you know, you get intimidated that, oh, it's across 290 degrees bend and will the guide go and do I need to change it and do I need to support it? But here again, you see that the guiding, it's a Judkin's right. It has aligned very well into this branch. And these curves are actually looking big on this, but they are not so intimidating on the LAO coral. They are five, and you can easily deliver stents down this and treat them. It's not so much of a problem. So with that, I will come to any comments from the panel. Then I'll come to the anamylous right coronary artery from the left sinus, which is, I think, the main thing.
So I think before going to anomalous RCA from left side, ma'am, for the benefit of the participants, we can discuss few points.
Yes.
One and foremost, for LCX, you said that there's the most common coming from the right sinus. It's usually missed if it's not coming from the common ostia from the RCA. Sometimes these anomalous LCX are usually missed and they are labeled as normal coming from left. So the pointer or the main gold rule, which we always tell to our residents also, that if you find a very unusually long left main, suppose the left side you're taking an angio, and you find a very unusually long left main of 12, 18 millimeter in length, always suspect that this is just an LAD, which is left main cut. LCX will be coming from other side. Second, I think we should have some discussion regarding what are the different catheters which has to be used, both from the radial side and from the femoral side, depending on the takeoff or the origin of the artery. I think ma'am showed very good examples, which she showed that, okay, the left was also coming from LAD from right side, and LCX is coming a little inferiorly and anteriorly. So it's always guide catheter in invoking the anomalous origins always should be coaxial, because these are the sites which will be not coaxial catheter. It will be always a risk for causing the dissection of the wall. So doing the coaxial, like ma'am told also, it always better to see whether it is an anteriorly arising or a posteriorly arising, which we usually see in a RAO view. So if it is an anteriorly arising, just give anti-clockwise and it will just directly book it. If it is going a little posterior, then you have a little of clockwise and it will become coaxial in that. So you want to add some point?
Anomalous LCX usually arises either from the right coronary artery or from the separate ostium from the right coronary sinus. Okay, and as Rupali madam has told, when to suspect it is a long left main and where you do not have any stump or you think that LCX is closed. But the thing is, as you come to the catheter, which is the best catheter to be used, majority of them get hooked with a Judkin right. In some cases, you might require a multipurpose because the Judkin might be stuck inside the right coronary artery. Some people suggest that you put a wire in RCA, that's a buckling wire. You push the wire distally, because of the buckling, the JR which is going deep into our stomach.
Yeah, no, I understand.
And then the LCX can be visualized. Am I audible?
Yeah.
So, Dr. Lalita, that JR saying it for the femoral root, or usually you prefer, or what it is?
Actually, even with the radial or with the femoral, it doesn't make a difference. The same catheter can be used for the radial as well as the femoral. This is because the JR usually gets sucked in, and once it goes deep in, you might be missing the LCX option. So, what they advise is to put a wire. If you can buckle it and push it distally. Because of the buckling, the JR will come back. And it comes up to the ostium, and then we can see the LCX. And in previous times, when LV angio was done, LCX anomalous was actually diagnosed by a dot posterior to the aorta. When you do an angio, LV angio, in the RAO position, you find a dot that is the end-on view of the LCX, which is posterior to the aorta, which was supposed to be a key finding to say that it is an anomalous LCX.
And one more thing is, whenever the anomalous LCX is present in the right coronary sinus, always the takeoff of the RCA and LCX is downward. It is very rare to have a horizontal or then upward takeoff. So the most of the time, the hooking is not at all a problem, because RCA jutsal is going to hook either from the radial or the femoral root. But versus the congenital heart diseases, when it is associated with a single coronary artery, it is really, most of the time, it is the case origin above the normal original site of an RCA. There the hooking becomes a little bit difficult. In a congenital heart diseases, we supposed to have a root angio when you have a suspension of the echo wise the single coronary artery, or otherwise taking origin of the LCX from the RCA. But in the adults, where there doesn't have another congenital heart disease, most of the time the both are inferior origin. So the hooking is not a problem.
Okay, so we now go to anomalous right coronary artery from the left coronary sinus. The largest publication of 24 cases, very well analyzed from Samim Sharma's cath lab by Sarkar, Kunal Sarkar, of 24 cases. What he did is he divides the aortic root in the plane of the coronaries and the aortoventricular plane, and a midline passing through that. And A, B, C, and D is given. A is above the sinotubular plane, B is below the left coronary artery, C is in between, and D is in the midline. And majority of the cases are actually between this position and C and D. That, two-thirds of the cases you will find in this position, a little above or a little below, you may not see. I mean, you also see as often, but more often it is in this C and D. And as you saw in the last case that I showed you in the common origin of the RCA, RCA comes from here and it goes downward in this direction. So it is along that line that you will find. And in the same article, what they gave the luxury of, they have a femoral curve left, a Q curve, a VODA, a forward takeoff, and this is a regular Judkins, and an AL1, AL2, or a Lea catheter in which the AL1 has a right angle deviation of the tip. I can tell you that this is a luxury which, I have never seen our cath labs have, even if we tell companies these catheters don't come. So I would only advise you, use the catheters you use every day, because it's not the shape of the catheter, it's the hands that manipulate them. I mean, literally, catheter ka kaan modna aana chahiye, and you have to learn how to make them sit in the vessels that you need them, and don't feel at a disadvantage if you don't have these fancy catheters on your shelf. If you do, very good, but use them and get used to them. Otherwise, use the catheters you are familiar with. So basically, what has been highlighted by the other people on the panel is that cannulation of the vessel can be technically sometimes difficult and time-consuming. So once you know the variation, see, the mind doesn't see what the eyes don't see, what the mind doesn't know. So when you know something in your mind, where to choose, where to select, where to move your catheter, your movements become a little more directed. And your aim is to get a stable guiding. And aligning the guide in the initial course of the vessel is extremely important. So selection of the catheter depends on the operator and the institution availability. And most important, you have to have your hands, you have to use them enough to be sure of what it is.
So just to remind
Yes, Rupali ma'am.
Dr. Lalita, I was just telling this, like the origin of RCA from the left sinus. The usual technique for hooking that catheter, what we should be advised, hook the left system. Just see where the left coronary artery is coming. Slightly de-hook it and rotate the catheter. And just wherever the ostium of RCA would be there, it will hook. So always, because what we see, because we are doing maximum cases radial, so like tight catheter, we don't change it, because left and right we do a normal thing, and the like resident is like struggling and all that. So if there is no RC coming from right sinus, we directly take the catheter, Tiger catheter, towards the left sinus, hook the left coronary artery, slightly dehook it, and then give a torque to the catheter, and if the right RC coming from the left sinus, it will directly jump into that.
Yeah.
That is the usual maneuver which we
use. Extremely, extremely useful in hooking an anomalous
right. Anomalous RCA, correct.
In fact, even
Rupama, can you go back to the previous slide?
I have, been peer review for a publication where they said that even from the groin they're using Tigers when they can't get it. So you know, all these things are in theory is fine, but when it comes to real life, each of us has our own experience. So here I have another patient with an inferior wall MI. And I know RCA is the culprit. And I know just above the left, I have to hook, de-hook, and a little bit I give a torque. And right above that, I'm going to see the right. I mean, I know it in my mind. And that's how I'm trying to look for it. And I've just gone through that article which I showed you of Sarkar, where he says it's Amplatz, or it's a EBU, or it's a VODA, or my favorite catheter is a left inverted. So here it is, Amplatz catheter. You see now, if it was arising from above there, it's fine. This is coming so far below. I mean, it's so small. Where do you get a catheter that is so small to flip and enter this point? It should have been high up there. It's very low. And then we change to a EBU catheter. And even this, there's no question of it's rotating or catching or getting anything done. There's no way it's going to get there. Now, this is my favorite catheter. I always, most of my cases I've done, I've flipped and undersized. There are people who use an oversized Judkins and flip it. I've never found that working. For me, this works, So here you see it's a Judkins left, which has been, you take the wire up, rotate it up, and you do it. So here, even the smallest Judkins is so far away from the ostium. There's nothing, I don't need to waste my time trying. I'm lucky, though the patient is infarcting, it's a flowing vessel. So I've given heparin and, this is way back in 2010. We didn't have ticagrelor. The patient is on a 2B3A, there's flow. It's okay, I have some time on my hands. So what I do is that I rotate it, flip it, rotate it little anti-clockwise, and I hold the catheter facing the ostium. And this is where teamwork comes in, where as I rotate and hold the catheter facing the ostium or aligned with the ostium, the wire is floated down the vessel by a colleague. Alone, I'm fortunate in a center where we can have a RAFO and people can do it. But it's only in one position where the catheter is counterclockwise rotated that it is aligned. So I need my right and left hand to align the catheter, and I need anyone, actually even a nurse could slip it down. The wire will find its way down the vessel, but the alignment and holding the catheter in place is extremely, extremely important. And as you know, when we advance anything into this, so here I advance a balloon down this vessel, and you see how the catheter flips back. But it's all right. Go very slowly, go very gently, let it slip back, and then I inflate the balloon. And once the balloon is inflated on the same wire without disrupting the same path that got pushed back, you see how I'm able to push the catheter in. And the same catheter has molded right into the ostium of the RCA. I mean, it's literally, the best way to describe is catheter ka kaan modna aana chahiye. That it's literally sitting in here, and you have the ability to mold these catheters with this balloon inflated. Now, these are different times. In 2010, we have catheters which are soft, which are flexible, which are atraumatic, which can be molded. This was not the case, 10 years earlier in 2002-03, and I'll show you another case of that time. So once this is done, deflate the balloon. You have such a beautifully sitting catheter. It's a cakewalk. Once your guide is fine, just, take it in, place a stent, get a good result, and it's all good. Nothing can make that catheter move from there, the way you've made it sit. And it's strange, it's atraumatic, and it's sitting there. So this technique of, you know, inflating a balloon and being very gentle, not harsh, no harsh movement, a little flick back of the catheter, no problem. Over an inflated balloon, slip the catheter back into the RCA is very helpful when the catheter, when the vessel is so much below the conventional positions where you think a catheter would easily flip into the vessel. Now, this is another example of a patient with a common artery, I think from the left, similar to what I've already shown, where you have a Judkins guide. Again, there's nothing to protect the LAD, and we've been able to do it. So this is again telling you the course. I've put it in between these slides. Is that is the course of an anamnous RCA from above the LAD, left main, down somewhere here, and where the previous case we saw it was really low. Now, this case is what I'd show you. This is way back in 2003. And this was the time when we used to, you know, use 8 French guides or 7 French guides, and we kept hot water in the cath lab, and we learned to twist the catheters because the guiding catheters were not so, you know, moldable as they are today. So this is again 3 in the morning. It's in a STEMI call, and the patient has an inferior MI. He's at VF. He's been shocked on the way to the cath lab, and here it is. No catheter guide was not going in, and all I'm getting in is a diagnostic. So it's all right. I mean, at least I have a diagnostic catheter in the vessel, because flipping a diagnostic catheter is much easier. And as you see, it's the same Judkins left 3, which is flipped over and it is into the vessel. Now, you can easily pass a wire down a diagnostic. You don't need a guiding for a diagnostic wire. And once it is there, even a small 1.5 millimeter balloon can be passed through a diagnostic and it can be done. So this is... In 2003, we were using 6 French diagnostic catheters, not a 5 French, but even a 1.5 balloon would go down any vessel. Now, so when you didn't have, when we had those stiff guides, so I'll just show you, this is the position actually of the guide. I'll just stop it. This is the catheter. So it's not in this plane, it's out of plane. So when we used hot water in the cath lab, we used to just twist the tip of the catheter out of the plane and hold it in that place. And then you have to very fast get it into the RCA, because as long as it stays in blood, again it will melt and be soft, and again you won't get it. So this is the curve we used to give catheters when we didn't have, you know, when we had stiffer catheters, and we had it to create these curves in the cath lab before we did anamnous vessel angioplasty. So now with the diagnostic in, so I decided that now the vessel is flowing, the heparin is in, I've pre-dilated it. I will change for a guiding catheter over the wire. So how you do it is that, you know, you leave a big loop in the ascending aorta. If you straight pull it out, you're going to get everything. So it is this loop where the movement will happen and your distal wire will not get out of sight. So leave a big loop. So from here's the RCA, there's a big loop in the aorta, and there the diagnostic catheter is coming out over a dock wire. And then take a guiding catheter. And so I have to learn how to mark it, but there's a huge loop of wire in the RCA. From the RCA, here it's coming, and there the loop is going. And the guiding catheter I'm getting up on this wire, 014, but if you see carefully, there's a 035 wire in the guide. If you just come up the 014 wire that we use for coronary angioplasty, everything will fall out. So the guiding is supported with a wire in the shaft. And over this loop, you hold it very carefully, never get the distal wire off your side, and comfortably rotate it in. And there you have the guiding catheter sitting in. And once it's sitting in, it's very easy to just go ahead and complete the angioplasty. So one I showed you was aligning the guide with the ostium, floating the wire in, and over a balloon, sleeving the guide and, you know, bending it to adapt. And this, when you are stuck and you can't do it, then another option is get the diagnostic, get the flow going in the vessel, and with a big loop in the aorta, change the diagnostic for a guiding catheter, not a problem at all. And a good result again with the angioplasty, and the patient obviously did well after that. So, so much so for anamnesis, and you know, I mean, I just felt I've seen a lot of anamnesis vessels, and this is amongst the, you know, again, 2003, when I was getting my independent consultancy, you're doing an unstable angina angio, and there, you know, there's nothing in the left main. So the next word is fine. Do a pigtail and you see whether anomalous is nothing in the right sinus. You spend a lot of time finding the vessel, you can't. And all the theory you read means nothing. Here what? There's nothing. There's no posterior dot. There's no anterior dot. There's no eye, nothing. There's something coming out from between the right and the left sinus. I mean, I've never seen or read or heard of anything like this. There's something funny coming out from here, and that's the only vessel the patient has. So, again, this was the inferior wall MI, come on a follow-up. So, with an Amplas catheter, we hooked it. Believe me, I took a lot of time. This is maybe the longest diagnostic angio I took, a good 20, 30 minutes to find this vessel, because it's just not where we are taught vessels are. And this is what it's doing. It's dividing into an RC that's proximally occluded and a vessel that's going backwards. And there's no question of seeing any LAD. Whatever it is, this is the LAD. But when you see it in an RO view, you see these huge OM branches. They're all wrapping around and coming. And there's no, and the rudimentary left, you know, main from the left sinus. And no discrete vessel that's going in the interventricular septum or filling that up. But this is all the vessels that the patient had. So this patient, these were the days of cipher where we did an angioplasty, put in a cipher out here and got an RCA that was wrapping around. Sorry, I couldn't find that angiogram. It's a real old one. But again, more for the unusual location between the right cusp and the left cusp at the commissure is why I've got this, because, you know, you're not taught in the normal training to go around looking for vessels in this odd position. Now, this patient, interestingly, even today comes on a follow-up from, you know, 70 years old now. He's close to 80 plus and he's doing fine. So, again, just for your view, it's an Amplas catheter vertically going down that Jyotsna ma'am just mentioned, that these catheters point downwards. And interestingly, a multipurpose didn't hook it well, but it was Amplas that really got into it. And we were able to do an angioplasty for the right artery, which was the culprit artery. Now, with that, any discussion, because we do have some time before I go to the, I think, the last case that I have for the anomalous right, would any of you like to discuss anything? Rupali?
Yeah, just I wanted to mention about the few of the anomalous origin of the right, which is above the sinotubular junctions.
Yeah.
And the most of the times what you are shown is the taking from the non-coronary sinus also, it can take an origin. Sorry? Am I audible?
Yes, yes.
Yeah. So the major problem that comes is if it is taking origin from the right coronary or the left coronary sinus, then the hooking, we have the many of the measures. But most major problem comes is if it is taking from the non-coronary sinus or above the sinotubular junctions. There are about all the anomalous origin of the right coronary arteries. 2% of the cases, it comes quite above the sinotubular junction. It could be a midway, the D line, what is shown on the Sarkar's classification. It can be the quite high above on the D line. Then the hooking becomes very difficult. There is a 3D RC catheter, which we used to have it. Now we don't have it. So that is the one which can give the engagement. It becomes an easy for that. And the second one is the bypass RC catheter. These are the catheters which are useful for the high origins of the RCA above the sinotubular junctions. And almost I can say that from the ascending aortas.
Yeah, I would treat them like we treat vein grafts. You know, use a multipurpose catheter like the same. They feel just like the RCA grafts, the vein grafts. And you can usually get them with a multipurpose if they are pointing downwards. And if they're not, then you need an Amplas AL1 is a very good catheter to find them. But just remember, they're never rarely horizontal. They're more vertically pointing downwards. And they have a slit-like ostium. So many times you will confuse it for a lesion, but it's very rare to get a lesion there. And on counter, in orthogonal views, you see it's oval. And you're able to get it with a multipurpose catheter.
When you talk of anomalous RCA,
same as a vein graft, when you do a RCA vein graft, or any try to hook the other grafts on the two walls of the aorta, it's a multipurpose catheter, anchor, hold the ostium, and then just bend it to get an alignment to the proximal part of the graft.
Am I audible?
Yeah, Dr. Lalita, you're audible.
Yeah. Anomalous RCA, actually, I think we require more of discussion because that's the most common anomaly we see. One thing is it can be an anomalous origin, in the right pulmonary sinus. Of course, it may not be completely a typical anomalous RCA, but yes, whatever is a deviation from the normal RCA is anomalous. So if you divide the anomalous RCA as origin from the right coronary or other coronary, usually the left sinus. Am I audible?
Dr. Rupa Selvan is not able to hear you, but all of us are able to.
Okay. Just discuss, no problem.
So as you said, this Sarkar classification is only for anomalous RCA arising from the left side, but it can still be simplified. That is, the normal origin of the left coronary sinus, if you take it at a base, anything arising above it, below it, or from the midline, you can classify it as into three things. So anything arising above the left ostium, according to Sarkar, the most common catheter that can be used is a JM. Some use it as an oversized JM, some use it as an undersized. And already the explanation has been given by ma'am why you take an oversized, because you can make a loop, and undersized because you can make a loop and pull it back. Whatever RCA is arising below the left coronary artery, you can do it with an undersized JM or you can go for an EPU. And whatever arises from the midline, as in the last case where it was arising between the two cusps, the ideal catheter will be an amplis instead of going for any other catheter. And of course, any high-tech catheter, it is always the amplis who has to be taken. That is for the abnormal RCA, which is arising from the left sinus. But what we more commonly see is an anomalous RCA, which is arising from the right sinus. Because we many a times we see that we are not able to hook the RCA properly. When we are trying to hook the RCA with a diagnostic JR, we see that we are not able to hook the RCA, but there is something, some segment coming above with a long segment also. So when do you actually suspect that the RCA is anomalous and arising from the right sinus itself? So in a non-selective, when you are doing a diagnostic right coronary angio, you see a long horizontal portion which is arising either above or below your catheter. That indicates that it is anomalous, but we are not sure from which sinus it is. Then come for the RAO view, and then you can make out from which sinus it is. Then whether it is anteriorly or posteriorly.
I can't hear anybody right now.
Are the others able to hear?
We are able to hear.
The main thing which we have to remember is, suppose you are not able to put the RCA, please do not come out to go for a second catheter. The most important point is, before you come out and go for a second catheter, take injection. Take a non-selective injection in the right sinus, in the left sinus, and if possible, a non-selective IO program. That is what has been described by Jim et al. It is known as a three-step process. Never go for a second catheter just because you are not able to hook the first catheter. You need to see where it is coming from. So before you go for a second catheter, you should be sure from where it is. So go for the three injections before coming out of the coronaries: a right sinus injection, left sinus, and a root injection. This will tell us what the next catheter you can select. When it comes to the anomalous RCA coming through the right sinus, it can be above the normal ostium, it can be below the normal ostium, or it can be at the same level but can be deviated anteriorly or posteriorly. So it depends on the angle of uptake. Suppose it is an upward taking, you have to go for an amplis. Suppose it is a horizontally taking, you just shifted anteriorly or posteriorly, you go for a Jenkins right. Suppose it is a downsloping, you go for a multipurpose. So this is ideal for anything coming from the right sinus. And there are the RCA which are coming above the sinotubular junction. In such cases, the amplis will be the best. It could be AL or AR. But there are few case reports we have shown that they have engaged even with the Jenkins. And such anomalous RCA are better hooked from the femoral tube, other than the high takeoff, that is high above the sinotubular RCA. All other anomalous RCAs can be hooked equally good from the radial or from the femoral.
Yeah, actually, Lalita published a paper on this anomalous coronary angioplasty, where she discussed about the 20 cases. Almost she described all these catheters and the ways to hook it and what are the complications can happen. I think Rupa Selvan can talk about the last case, and then we can talk about the what are the complications can happen which we are supposed to be avoided.
Yeah, should I go to the last case?
Please, madam.
Okay, so what, as I told you, was that when we started, anomalies are those which are seen in less than 1% of the population. It can be about the origin, about the course, and about the termination of the vessel. So the last angio case I'm going to show you is about the termination of a vessel. So you see a patient who's come in heart failure, and when we do an angiogram, we see that he has a huge vessel. And you can't define where the left LAD is. It looks like the circumflex. It's winding around. It's going into the right, into the RV. So this is maybe the only time in my life I've actually put a pigtail all the way down into the circumflex and used a pressure injector, because however you treat this fistula, unless you don't define the course, how will you treat it ever? So it's a pigtail shoot with a pressure injector in the circumflex. And you see what a huge fistula that you have that is draining into the RV. And a guiding just didn't help, you know. So guiding just, it was all with your hand, you can do it, nothing. So anyway, we took it up. And this was, I think, way back again in 2004, where this was the first Amplatz plug occluder that was used ever. So the normal way of closing these devices, exteriorize the wire, cross it, snare it out. And the plug didn't have a membrane, so we had to put a lot of coils to kind of close it. And that was what was done. And then, you know, after placing those coils, you leave it, the flow reduces on a follow-up, this closes off. And you see how it is, one coil, in fact, you can see has jumped back, and you have to really go deep into it and see that the coils stay where they are, and they're not just floating around this huge thing. And yeah, so that is a huge coronary aneurysm, AV fistula that is opening into the RV near the apex, which we closed with the Amplatz occluder and coils. So with that, I thank you all for your attention and wish you the best for all your cases. No case is ordinary, no case is routine. Each case teaches us. Our experience helps you, but I can't say that it's the last word on intervention. And each of you will, I'm sure, have a nicer story to tell, which you should come back to us and share your experiences with us. So thank you very much, everybody, for discussion.
No, would you like to talk about any complications occurred when you're doing these angioplasties?
That's what, no, you know, you're so careful because, you know, they're out of routine. You're careful, you're not rash, your wire movements are good. That's what I've never, I mean, at least in anamnesis, the whole lab is so alert that I have not encountered any complication in an anamnesis vessel. Whether it's a dissection, air embolism, thrombus, these are the normal things, you know, but if you anticipate them and you're careful, I think you're very careful when you're doing anamnesis vessels. I have not come across any complications while doing anamnesis vessels.
Well, can I add something?
So yeah.
We were not very lucky in having no complications. See, in issue with anomalies is that two things. One is hooking. So once you're guided in hook, you are okay. The other thing, you have to be coaxial. Third important is you have to have good support of guide so that all the balloons or the stent have an easy trackability. So these are the important issues which we usually feel with the anomalies. For hooking stuff, I think ma'am clearly showed very beautiful examples of what are the different guides which can be used and to hook it, the maneuvers which has to be taken as guides. The important is having a good coaxiality and good support. So sometimes these anomalies are not having a very good support. So a few cases we have used a guideliner in these cases. If sometimes the guide doesn't go so deep or it's not able to hook that anomalous origin, stent or maybe a more regulation classified, we are not able to transfer it. So guideliner is a good option which can be used in these cases. Regarding the complication stuff, there is more very high chances in cases of going for an anomalous RCA coming from a left coronary. Like we had one case that RCA was arising from the left coronary sinus. It was having a, I would say, a type origin. And we hooked with the EBU during the radial procedure, and we hooked with the EBU because we did LAD and just rotating it more posteriorly, we were able to hook the RCA. Procedure went well, everything went okay, but the last angio, either the catheter was against the wall or what, it dissected the ostea of the RCA. So while fixing the ostea of the RCA, the dissection extended up to the left main. So at a time, both the arteries with the same resection flap, it got occluded. So the patient crashed on the table. But so we were lucky. This is the EBU was the only catheter which hooked both the arteries. We immediately sealed the resection flap in the RCA, and immediately so the same catheter we hooked the limb. So I don't know, but the anomalous, I think they have a little high chances for complication rate. And you have to be a little more careful, with especially with coaxiality and having a good backup. So what's your experience?
I would say that I'm using Judkins left flipped. And in a Judkins left flipped, this trauma, EBU is a very traumatic catheter. If you do, I mean, it makes it easy. You get into vessels very fast, but it's supporting the opposite wall. It's hitting into your vessel. So, and these are out of plane vessels. So, you know, the downside is the time when I've trained, the technology was so primitive. Your catheter skills and hand movements were very fine because everything came out. You know, so everything came out so easily. You are very used to moving very fine. Now, you all are working in a time where the catheters are wonderful. They are soft. The wires just slip in like magic. The profile of the stents are so good. I mean, I've trained in the time when we used to crimp stents and they used to slip off, and you know, you literally held your breath and worked very carefully. So what you're saying, I totally understand, because in EBU, as I showed you, it's not in one plane. The apex is out. So when you're out and you're rotating it back, you will tear something, you know, and EBU is far more traumatic. So be very cautious, and it's a great learning. I mean, as we shift to radial and we do more of them, particularly if it's a, I think if it's a mixed thing, I would say go femoral in a case that is as tricky as this. I would still, I mean, almost most of my anamnesis right are with a flip Judkins left, which is so, I mean, forgiving, because it takes that 90-degree bend much more easily than an EBU. So a VODA and an EBU would be very, very traumatic because they anchor on the opposite wall and they're tearing the vessel apart on this side. So I've seen another patient, not like this, but with an amplatz, when it was touching the wall. So the moment you dissect, the key learning is stop injecting dye. Because with every puff, you are just perpetuating the dissection. So I've seen a dissection perpetuate from the RCA all the way to the carotid, involving the whole ascending aorta and going down the vessel also. So just stop seeing it. Remember your image. Quickly track the entry point, because every shot you give, you will perpetuate, you will propagate that dissection. You have no idea in which direction.
I totally agree with that. This is the basic training, that with dissection, once you see, you should not inject it with it. Regarding the other stuff, the catheter which we find very useful in our like anomalous one are the SAL catheters. SAL catheters, especially if the RCA is coming to the left sinus. So giving a little torque, keeping in the left sinus, these catheters fit very beautifully in the RCA. So that's the radial. I think these catheters can be easily used. And I want to tell you, accept that if you're having an anomalous, shift to a femoral if you're not able to do the right radial.
You never think that it is very easy. Abhi maine hook kiya, abhi main karke aa jaungi. Please, most of us make errors when we never take, I mean, have respect for all the corneas. All of what I've seen is, most errors happen when you're just too confident. Oh, it's so easy. It's not easy. Things happen with time, and your skills need to mature. Please, above complications. All of us have to go with the utmost humility to the cath lab every day. Most happen when your guard is down and you just think it's so easy. Nothing is easy, you know. You have to be very much there while you're working. And be honest telling it. I mean, I think the biggest thing Vinkas will get to you is that we get you an honesty, which, you know, we don't need to show off. We don't need to pretend that something is so cool and so fine. And, you know, there's the equipment and there I did it. Sorry. Everything works fine. And we are quite comfortable telling, particularly all the youngsters and all people in training, please be humble and be very careful in the cath lab. It'll never let you down.
Yeah, I wanted to tell about a case actually similar to Rupali Khanna was mentioning. The anomalous RCA, we did the angioplasty and everything. Last injection was not very clear. So we thought that it is not properly hooking. So we removed the wire and then we gave an injection. The whole thing is dissected. So the thing is, whenever the anomalous canary is there, if your wire is there, most of the time you are very safe because the guide will be directing you towards to the lumen of the anomalous vessel. So the dissection doesn't happen. Once you remove the wire, the angulation of the tip of the catheter to the anomalous artery will change and it causes the dissection. So at the time, you have to be very clear, very cautious and giving a last injection. We think that we can have a better injection and we give it. Better to avoid it. This thing has happened to us also on table once.
Yeah, yeah. So when you remove the wire, either you take your final shot with the soft part, the soft part floating, or remove everything, go back to a diagnostic, take your final shot with that. But again, no shortcuts. Any forceful injection when you're not seeing, you're touching something else. It has no feel. So dissection has no feel. And it's not the stronger, the better the breakfast you've eaten and the more forceful the injection, the more you'll see the vessel. If you're not aligned, don't even force your way through the vessel.
Anyone has any other comments? I have not seen any questions in the chat. If there are no questions, I am thankful to all the people for an excellent presentation by the Rupa Salvan madam and showed so many cases. Rupali's and Lalita's comments really made us a day today. Thank you very much to all.